Thank you, Brother Sam, for reading out this verse very well. We'll look at the whole chapter of the whole 17th chapter of 1 Samuel, but for the preaching purposes, we'll read verses 45. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 45. The Bible says, "Then David said to the Philistine, 'Thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied.'" May God add a rich blessing into the word. Amen.
Amen.
Our Father and our God, we pray this morning that as we enter into your words, we pray that you will enter into our hearts. This word is not like any other book that we read. This is not like any other magazine that we read. This is your word, inspired by your spirit. And in order for us to understand your word, your purpose, we need your spirit to come into our hearts and lead us into all righteousness and into all truth. For the glory of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, God tells Samuel, his prophet, that I have rejected King Saul. I have rejected King Saul, and therefore go into the house of Jesse, and you will find a king in the house of Jesse. So Samuel hesitantly goes to Jesse's house. Of course, he goes a bit scared because he knows that if Saul is to find out that he has gone to anoint another king, he will be in trouble. He doesn't want to cross paths with the king. But he goes hesitantly and he enters Jesse's house and he tells Jesse that God has chosen a king from this house. If I was to make a title for this sermon, I would say that there is a king in this house. Hallelujah. There is a king. For God has sent me to anoint a king from this house. And Jesse calls out his boys. He calls out his oldest boy. And Samuel looks at the boy. Samuel likes the boy. But God tells Samuel that he is not the one. The second boy is called. He is not the one. The third one is called. He is not the one. The fourth one likewise. The fifth one likewise. And it seems to me that the more perfect they appeared for the task, the more they were rejected. The more perfect they looked for the task, the more they were rejected. Seven boys are called, and God instructs Samuel by telling him that these seven boys presented to you are not the people I need. And so finally Samuel asks Jesse, "Are these all the boys? Is this everyone in your household?" And Samuel, Jesse says, "Well, there is another one. But he is just a young boy. There is another one, and he really does not look like a king. There is another one. He is not matured enough to be anointed as the king. There is another one. But honestly, I am their father. I know my voice. There is nothing kingly about this other one. He is just but a shepherd. And as I'm talking to you, he is not invited here because he is just but a shepherd." Isn't it interesting that the anointed person was not invited for his own anointing? Hello? And be careful not to invite people for their anointing. So finally the boy is called, and as the boy comes into the house, God tells Samuel, "That's the next king of Israel.
Amen.
That's the person I need. He may not look like it, He may not dress like it. He may not smell like it. But that's the person I need. And my Bible tells me that Samuel anoints David. At a very young age, David is anointed as the king of Israel. But this is interesting. After David is anointed, David does not go to sit on the kingly throne. After his anointing, David goes back to tend the sheep and the flock. Listen to your pastor this morning. There is a difference between anointment and appointment. You read to your pastor. There is a huge difference between anointment and appointment. David knew that he was anointed as the next king of Israel, but he knew very well that he was not yet appointed. And some of us, if not most of us, God has anointed us for great things in this life. But we mess it up before we reach our appointment. We kill the anointment before reaching the appointment. You could be anointed to become a wife someday. But most girls, most ladies, kill their anointment before their appointment. You might be anointed for a good job, and you're probably anointed to take your boss's spot in the office. But how you behave in between the anointment and the appointment will lead you into reaching the appointment with the anointment. Are you hearing your pastor? Most of us misbehave after the anointment. If I were David, I would have said, I am the king. The prophet has poured his oil on me. I am the king. I will not go back to take care of sheep. I am the king. I will not go back into the field. I am the king. But David knew it very well that though I am anointed today, I am yet awaiting my appointment. And my anointment will not stop me from my appointment, but my anointment will help me remain cool as I head for my appointment. What is your pastor saying this morning? You may be appointed. Remain calm as you walk to your appointment. You may be anointed. Remain humble as you walk to your appointment. Most of us, we have killed our appointment because of pride and arrogance and bad morals. Though you're anointed, remain cool, calm, and collected as you walk into your appointment. Hallelujah. And I'm talking to young men and young ladies. You have a bright future ahead of you. You are anointed for greatness. You are to change the paradigms of this world. I'm talking to you, young people. There is a very bright future ahead of you. Walk humbly as you head to your appointment. And in the fullness of time, your appointment is on the way. You will get there. Don't kill your anointment. We kill our purpose in life before we reach our appointment. So David, God's there to take care of the ship. Yes, the oil is running on his head. And here he is fighting, talking, and singing for ship and gods. One day his father sent him. He said, David, your brothers are out there in the battlefield, in the valley of Elah. Please go and take this food for them. And David carries the food and he goes to the battlefield. And as he gets to the battlefield, a voice is heard. A voice of a Philistine, a voice of Goliath, defying the God of Israel. And as this voice is heard, all the Israelites run into their tents, scared and terrified of Goliath. And as they are hiding in their tents, David asks the soldiers, why are we running? Why are we hiding? Well, can you not hear Goliath? Yeah, I can hear him. But why are we hiding? Well, we're scared. And David poses the question, what shall be given to a man that will kill Goliath? What shall be given to a man that will kill Goliath? David is not asking this question out of greed. He is asking this question out of assurance that I know my God is able to deal with that man. He is sure and he knows it. So he's not asking out of greed. He's not asking because he wants something. He is asking because he knows that he has a God who is all powerful to deal with his enemies. What shall be done to a man that will kill Goliath? And listen to this. When his brothers heard him, in fact, it was the older brother that was rejected by God. When he heard him, he told David, shut up. You are just a young boy. You have a single responsibility here. To bring food and go back to take care of your sheep. That's all you're good for. Shut up. And he goes as far as telling him, I know your pride. I know your heart. And in fact, he says that you have a bad heart. Isn't it interesting, Brother Paul, that David had to fight his brothers before fighting the enemy? Think of it. This was his brother. The brother was supposed to encourage him. The brother was supposed to strengthen him. The brother was supposed to empower him. But David found himself fighting his brothers before fighting the enemies. And here I am, as the Magomeni church pastor, pleading with you, my church members, when you see your brother walking into that door, please empower him,
Amen.
Encourage him,
Amen.
Strengthen him. Mm. You are here to strengthen your brothers, but not to fight with your brothers.
Oh, yes.
I thought you would say amen.
Amen.
I once said it to this church that it is already complicated being a Seventh-day Adventist, my Lord.
Mm-hmm.
It is already complicated being a Seventh-day Adventist. It's hard by itself. There are certain foods you don't eat simply because you're a Seventh-day Adventist. There are certain drinks you don't drink simply because you're a Seventh-day Adventist. There are certain places you do not go simply because you're a Seventh-day Adventist. For ladies, there are certain attires you do not wear simply because you're Seventh-day Adventist. Being an Adventist by itself is challenging. Being an Adventist, you're almost swimming against the currents. I mean, everyone else marries on a Saturday, but you, an Adventist, have to marry on a Sunday. And you have to explain the people of God. We are a family. My son, you are my brother. I am your brother. After a long, hard week out there, when you walk into the house of God, from the bottom part of my heart, I should be ready to tell you happy Sabbath. I am so glad to meet you. Welcome to the house of God. This is a place of peace. This is a place of rest. Is there anything you want me to pray for in your life? Are you struggling with anything and you need my assistance? Is there anything you want us to talk about? Do you need a verse for encouragement? We are brothers.
Absolutely.
And we don't fight our brothers. We empower, we strengthen, we encourage each other. David had to fight his brothers before fighting Goliath. Well, he overcame the battle with his brothers. I have 5 more minutes. I don't know. Maybe we should do a part 2 to this sermon as well?
Yes.
Yeah, we should do a part 2. Mr. Presider, is that okay? I don't think we'll finish it today. It's a long one. Yeah.
Next week.
Next week. By the grace of God.
Amen.
He overcomes his brothers. He finally makes it to the king of Israel. Now, look at this. Here is King Saul, the rejected king, but sitting on the throne. Here is David, the anointed king, but smelling like sheep.
Mm-hmm.
Hello?
Oh, yes.
And David tells the reigning king that I want to fight that Philistine. This brother, the king of Israel, who, by the way, he was chosen because of two qualities. He was the tallest and he was the most handsome. Those are the qualities. This brother tells David, you're just but a young man. You're just but a youth. And if the rest of the soldiers here are hiding in their tents, and you are but just a young man, I mean, you can't fight this man. And David goes on to tell the king that, you know what, since I was born, I have been taking care of my father's sheep, and honestly speaking, out there in the fields, a bear will come and a lion will come, and when they snatch my lamb out, I will go and I will fight the bear. Well, we are talking about Goliath here, we are talking about a lion. And he says, well, when the lion jumps on me, I will hold on its beard. And I really, really want you to know that there is a huge difference between a lion and a dog. When we got married, I'll give you this. When we got married with Aika, we went to Serengeti as our honeymoon, and we slept into the tents. Well, the next day, some guys came from America. They were a young couple as well. Were they married? Were they engaged? I don't know. But they came in and they joined us. They were sleeping in the tents as well. So this particular evening, after we had finished our trip, we were having dinner, and the guy, there were two people, a young man and a young lady. Well, the young man was complaining to their tour guide that I haven't seen a lion. I cannot come to Africa and go back without seeing a lion. I must see a lion. And you know what? I'm not only interested in seeing a lion, but I must catch a lion before I go back to America. We were all listening to this conversation. And I told Aika, my dear beloved wife, let's watch a man. Let's watch a man. And he was complaining, he was shouting at his tour guide, I want to touch a lion. I must touch a lion. The tour guide was like, you know what? You will see a lion. But I will not allow you to touch a lion. But a man! No, but with the jungle out here. So we went to the out for our roots. When we came back in the evening, he kept on complaining. I want to see a lion, but I don't want only to see a lion, I want to touch a lion. This poor guy was speaking in Swahili. Akasema, najua simba wali, lakini kumjinga sasa kumbeleka kwenye simba, maana atakuletea shida. Kwa hiyo akawa anamzungusha Serengeti, lakini anawakwepa simba makusudi ili huyu bwana asione simba, akajaribiwa kumgusa. But praise be to God, as we were sleeping that night, lions came to our tent. It so happened that there is water. Hapo kuna sehemu tunanawa mikono na nini, kuna maji. So it so happened that lions actually came to that place to drink water. So lions came. And at night, a lion roared. I mean, I felt the roar in my stomach. And my wife, remember, this is the second week into our marriage. And my wife cried out to me. And I was thinking, why are you holding me? I mean, don't hold me, you better hold on to God. And then I unrolled for the second time. I remember I was very clear with my God, Lord. Now, into thy hand I commence. I mean, I don't know the end of the world. Now, when the lion rolled for the second time, the gentleman next to our tent woke up and he started screaming out of fear. Oh no! Oh no, God, we're going to die! And I don't know what happened. I think the lion thought it was a joke, a game, or something. So they went in the second playing around their tent. They started throwing themselves around the tent. And the moment the lion threw themselves on their tent, we heard the gentleman screaming, oh Lord, I do not come to die in Africa. Help us! And we could actually hear the wife calming him down. The wife was like, hey, shut up. Quiet. No, we are dying. We are dying, oh God, we are dying out there. And the man screamed. The tour guards were sleeping in their car, so when they heard, they just switched on the engines and they turned their lights on, facing our tents, and the lions walked away. We were about 7-8 lions. So when we woke up the next morning, hello. Now David says, when a lion jumped on me, I grabbed it by its beard. So worry not, I will deal with this thing. Saul looks at this young man, and he knows that this young man is going to die. He says, well, as a king, I don't want to get the blame. Can I just give you my war clothes? Can I just... And the Bible says that David was dressed in soldier attires. And as he tried to move, he could not move. And David told Saul, I am good. I am okay. Thank you very much, but I'm fine the way I am. Two quick points before we close this service. This is part one. Point number one, do not change your tactics based on the giant before you.
Amen.
You're not hearing your pastor. Do not change your tactics based on the giant before you. Remain true and faithful to who God has created you to be. And He will bless you the way you are. Some people will have to grind for them to get a promotion. You don't have to change your tactics. Remain true and faithful. God will still bless you. You're not hearing your pastor. Some people facing a different Goliath will have to lie so that they get away. Saul's attack. Let me just finish with this. You are David. You don't need Saul's attire to win the giant before you. Be true to who you are. My attires are prayers and Bible reading. Remain true to that. God will bless you on that. Hallelujah. The problem is that most of us, we change our tactics. We change our attire based on the giant before us. Just remain true to who God created you to be. He will bless you the way you are. He will be with you the way you are. He will guide you the way you are. He will shield you the way you are. Don't be tempted to change who you are.
Amen.
That's the problem with most of us. When we're in the church, we change our attire into church life. When we're at work, we have a work attire. When we're in the streets, we have the streets attire. When we go to the market, no. Be true. But let's just call this part one. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. By the grace of God, we will finish part two. But may our good God bless you. May his face shine upon you.
Amen.
May he lead your footsteps.
Amen.
And may his countenance fall upon you.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.